So, Jiva, we said we're going to look at these things called categories, which we're also going to use to look at informal protocols, or all will become clear, I'm sure, but categories.
Right, categories. So, regardless of how well designed a third-party framework is, inevitably there's cases where there will be circumstances that the designers of third-party libraries just didn't anticipate. Cases where you might want some additional functionality on some particular class that they just didn't think of. And it would be really convenient if, rather than having to inherit from that class and create your own, if you could just somehow like kind of reach inside that class and add the functionality yourself. Obviously, it's pretty complicated to do that if you don't have access to the source code. But fortunately, Objective-C actually provides you with a capability to do basically exactly that. And that technology is categories.
That sounds powerful.
It is powerful. It is also kind of dangerous, too, if
Right,
you think
okay.
about it, because it's like the Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility. You want to be a little careful when you're using these technologies because it can be really easy. If you add all these functions to third-party frameworks, somebody who then comes in and is already familiar with that third-party framework, they might look at these classes and go, what the heck is this stuff? But we'll talk about that in a minute. So, if you can imagine, for example, one of the examples that I like to use is the idea of I like to use GUIDs in a lot of my applications. A GUID is a globally unique identifier, and it would be really convenient if NS string, for example, provided just a mechanism for me to create an NS string and have it actually have a GUID already filled in it, right?
Right, okay.
So obviously, I don't have access to the NS string source code. But if I did, then I could just modify the source code and add this function. But I don't. So categories gives us an ability to do exactly that. We can actually modify the existing NS string class and add this functionality to it. So for example, let's take a look at this example code here. To create a category, you essentially declare an interface on a class that already exists. In this particular case, I'm declaring an interface on NS mutable string.
Okay, which is an existing class within the foundation frameworks.
Right, which we'll talk about later. Sorry.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's an existing class inside the foundation framework. So you just declare this interface, and then you put in parentheses after the class name, you put the name of your category. In this particular case, I'm calling this category GUID, right? And then you declare any of the methods that you want to add to that category. In this particular case, I'm adding an append GUID method. Okay? Then in your implementation file for this class, you do the same thing. You've got implementation and then the category name in parentheses, and then you put in your method that you wanted to add to this particular class. By doing this actually makes this method be part of not just the be basically part of NS mutable string anywhere in your application. So you can now have this available right on any existing instances of NS mutable string.
You say I can have it. Do I have to do anything to make sure I get it, or is it
You
just
do.
there?
There is one thing you have to do to make sure that you get it, and that is basically, you just have to include the header file for this guy. So
Right.
let's take a look at how it's actually used. If we go over here, I've actually got a case where, so I'm including my NS mutable string plus GUID.h file.
Is that, I mean, that's an interesting name. Is that a standard that sort of people recommend, or
It's
something
kind of a
you've just made
standard.
up,
It's
or?
kind of a standard. I think I saw a while back somebody did like a little poll of, what they use for their naming conventions for protocols. And class name plus whatever your category name was sort of the most commonly used one. In fact, I think that's the standard that Apple uses. Frankly, if it was up to me, I'd actually put under bars in there, but you know, I'm just following the standard. So plus is good. I guess I don't like the plus because it just, I don't like how it fits in with the file names. But anyway, so that said, yeah, using the plus there is kind of a standard. So once I've included that, now all of my NSMutable strings now have that append GUID method automatically in them, which is really cool. So in other words, here, where I'm actually using an NSMutable string, I can now call append GUID, and it'll work, just like append GUID was always part of NSMutable string. Really, really cool, really powerful.
Now, people's first reaction might be, that's good, but so what? But I think after a while, you realize that actually, you know, if you had to subclass to do this, mm-hmm. you would then have to change every method
exactly
to take your NSString subclass
exactly.
instead of NSString if you wanted to access this. Whereas
exactly.
now anything that takes NSString, you can pass strings around, or NSMutable
yes.
strings as it is in this case, pass them around, and then just when you're ready, call it. So
yes.
you don't change anything else, and it all just works.
Right. It allows you to extend existing classes without using inheritance. You know, at the end of the day, inheritance is a great tool, but relying strictly on inheritance for all of your class extension needs is really not all that practical. It really doesn't work in the real world. Really, you need these kinds of tools to do a lot of this kind of stuff.
So, just to raise another debating issue, mm-hmm. I guess, as opposed to a technical syntactical one. There are a number of people who say that we shouldn't, you know, the way we name the methods within our categories is important, because if I was new to Objective-C in Foundation, mm-hmm. as we're assuming a lot of people watching this are, you know, I have no way of knowing when I see that code that, you know, append GUID is something that, you know, a developer in our organization or me 6 months ago
right.
added to NSMutable string. It just looks like it's part of it, which is part of the power.
Right.
And some people argue that you should actually put something in the name to remind yourself of that.
Do you really want to open this debate can of worms? Because the truth is, I think I'll fall on the opposite side of you.
No, I'm just asking what you feel. I mean, I can understand. As someone who's come to a new code base that I was given to work on, and it was full of categories,
mm-hmm.
Especially on NSString and NSDate and NSNumber, all classes we're going to look at later on. As a new person to this, it was really hard for me to understand, because, you know, I go to the documentation. There's no append GUID in the documentation,
right.
in whatever else here. And in some ways, it would have been easier for me at that stage just to have known
mm-hmm.
that this is something that's been added through a category
mm-hmm.
just by simply naming it there.
I raise it
so people can think about it.
No, it's an interesting point. Of course, Apple recommends, and it is a good practice, probably, to prefix your category method names with some kind of prefix to indicate that it's yours, so that it doesn't possibly conflict with a method that Apple might include.
Because also in the next release, they may have an append GUID.
Exactly,
then
they might.
Then what happens?
They might. And in fact, actually, that occasionally bites particularly iOS developers, because the iOS developers, of course, have to go through the approval process, and Apple will scan their executables to see if they're using any private APIs. And it's entirely possible that you might accidentally name one of your methods the same method, the same name as one of Apple's private API names. And if you did that, then your application will get rejected. So it is kind of a good practice to prefix your method names with something, right?
You don't like it.
I don't like it.
That's fine.
I don't like it because I like nice, clean method names like that. A, right?
Jiva, you're entitled to be wrong sometimes.
No, that's all right. Secondly, if you notice, of course, Apple, of course, always prefixes their stuff with NS or recently, of course, UI or CD, as in core data, and stuff like that, right? And so, frankly, with the fact that Apple is doing all of this prefixing, I think you're just as likely to run into conflicts with them because of their prefixes as you are without. So, but Apple does recommend it, and so you should probably do that if that's something that is important to you. Anyway.
Very well done. There's a politician in you there somewhere, isn't there?
Yeah, something like that. So let's talk about a couple of other things related to categories. Of course, you can make a category not just you can make categories with not just object methods. You can also do it with class methods too. So, for example, again, kind of extending my append GUID method. What if I wanted to have another method, like a class method, that would construct an NS mutable string for me with a GUID already in it? So, in other words, for example, like let's say I wanted to do something like this, where I say NS mutable string string with GUID, right?
Right. Yep.
So, in other words, this is a class method string with GUID. It's right there on NS mutable string, and this is a really nice little way to just create a string and it's already got a GUID in it. So how do you do this? Well, it's exactly the same way. You basically just define your class method as part of your interface in your category, just like you did with the append GUID method. And but of course, in this case, you've got a plus on the front of it instead of a hyphen, so you're defining a class method. Same thing in your implementation. Very straightforward, same stuff. So pretty basic things there. Now, one other thing you do need to know, of course, is that categories can't add any member variables. You can only add methods with categories. You can't actually add member variables to the classes. So they are a little bit limited in that regard. You know, if you need to, if whatever you are building with your category absolutely requires additional data members on the class itself, then you might either have to use inheritance or possibly delegate it off to some other class that you use inside of your category. Hmm. So remember that there's no working with member variables here. Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
So that's really the gist of categories. You can use categories for extending classes, either in the Cocoa frameworks in Foundation. You can use it for third-party, any kind of third-party frameworks. You can even use it for your own classes as well. In fact, there's cases where you might, for example, want to group similar functionality for particular classes all in one file. Like, let's say that you have some kind of functionality that is going to be used in multiple other classes, and you want to have this functionality all in one file so that you can look at it all together. Then what you can do is you can actually use categories to put those implementations all in one file, even though they're going off and they're actually implementations for maybe 5 or 10 other classes, but it's all in one place and you're using categories to do that.
Neat.
We also talked about it's also possible, for example, to use categories to actually define private methods. And you can do that by actually creating a category that only you know to actually include, right? So you can use this category, and you don't include that category as part of your public API. And since users of your class don't automatically get that category and they don't know about it, then they won't know that those methods are there, even though they are. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
So again, you've kind of separated out those private methods into a category, and only you use that category. You don't make it public. And then, of course, we talked in the last section about informal protocols and how you can use a category on NS object instead of, like here, where we're doing it with NS mutable string. You can actually do the same thing, but do it on NS object to create an informal protocol. I'll show you an example of that right here. So here is an informal protocol called My Protocol, and it's defined as a category on NS object, and it just has this My Protocol method on it. Just basic, straightforward stuff.
So it's a straightforward category. There's nothing special.
Exactly. And then you can have the implementation of that be whatever you want it to be. Now, there are some caveats when working with informal protocols and working with categories on NSObject. NSObject is a special object. You know, it's the parent of all other objects. You want to make sure that when you're working with categories on NSObject, realize that every other class in your object hierarchy is going to get these methods, right? So you really need to look out for those problems like, you know, naming collisions and those kinds of things. In addition to that, if in your category you should accidentally call super, right, realize that NSObject has no super because NSObject is the top level object. Right. And let's just put it this way, that is undefined behavior. What'll happen there?
Which is generally considered to be bad.
Exactly.
We haven't done that for a while.
No,
we would do a whatever they call it.
It needed to be done. So that's categories.
That's you know, really staggeringly powerful, actually.
It is. It's very powerful. It's one of, in my opinion, one of the most powerful tools that Objective-C has.
And I think so powerful that, in my opinion, which may be totally invalid, people can get a bit carried away with it. And you come across code that is just so full of categories that it's could have been done other ways.
I hope never to see a code base like that, but I know what you're talking about. Yes, that's possible.
So be warned. We will come and look. Right, what's going to be next?
Next up, we're going to talk about writing macros.
Macros. So we're dropping back a bit. Some of
dropping
stuff
back in. A little bit. It's a good time to do it. We're going to get that taken care of.
Okay, so cup of coffee time and then macros.
Yeah. Thank you.